1957. The American way of life had defeated Japanese imperialism and Nazi tyranny, and few things symbolized that way of life more than the game of baseball. It was a golden era for the game. From professional ballparks to sandlots across the 48 states, boys and men played baseball. South of the Texas border lay the industrial city of Monterrey, Mexico. 24 hours a day, factories poured out black smoke as furnaces produced glass, steel, and cement. Men toiled at dangerous jobs for poverty-level wages, and life held little promise for the forsaken children of Monterrey.
Bob Grimm delivers to Gil Hodges, who sends a fly.
There was one ray of light. On Sundays after church services, the boys would listen to Spanish radio broadcasts from Ebbets Field, where they would dream of playing baseball like their heroes, the Brooklyn Dodgers. And from the light came an idea. The boys decided to build a field of their own. In the shadows of the steel foundry, they cleaned a dirt lot of rocks, broken glass, and twisted metal. And as boys will be boys, they took on the personas of their heroes, Sandy Koufax, Duke Snyder, Roy Campanella, Gil Hodges, calling themselves by the names of the baseball legends they'd never even seen. They wanted to make a real Little League team, dress up in real uniforms, and play one real baseball game in America. But they needed a coach, someone who knew the game. There was one such man, a former bat boy from Texas named Cesar Faz. On July 28, 1957, Cesar Faz and the 14 boys of Monterrey Industrial took a bus to the southern banks of the Rio Grande. Crossing the river that divided two worlds, they walked 10 miles across barren desert to the Little League field in McAllen, Texas. They entered the U.S. with a three-day visa. They didn't expect to win, so all they had were the uniforms on their backs and a change of underwear. Miraculously, nine victories later, Monterrey Industrial conquered Texas in the state championship. Back home in Monterrey, eager parents read of their son's exploits in the newspapers, proud yet anxious, as the team then headed for Louisville, Kentucky for the Southern Regional Playoffs. Behind the great pitching of Angel Macias and Enrique Suarez, they dominated their rivals. Earning them a berth in the 1957 World Series in Williamsport, Pennsylvania.
Just let me hear some of that rock and roll.
On average, they weighed 35 pounds less and stood 8 inches shorter than the American kids. Besides the challenge of defeating one great baseball team after another, tremendous obstacles threatened to end their dream at every turn. Overcoming racism, immigration problems, homesickness, and a total lack of money, they had become an unstoppable force, winning the semifinal game against Bridgeport, Connecticut by the score of 2-1. They prepared to meet the heavily favored powerhouse team from La Mesa, California. One of the 16,000 fans could imagine what they were about to witness. A bunch of poor Mexican kids with hand-sewn gloves were beating the best America had to offer. Angel Macias had pitched the only perfect game in championship history, a record that still stands to this day. They were world champions. It was a miracle. But the best was yet to come. Invited to New York City, they entered Ebbets Field as the guests of their heroes, the Brooklyn Dodgers.
And Dodger hopes for a World Series victory at long last.
Traveling on to Washington, D.C., they're received by President Eisenhower. When the boys finally returned to Monterey, over 500,000 people took to the streets to welcome them home in a sea of pride, joy, and tears.